to be together. I love Sunday mornings. I love the opportunity I get to walk around and say hello, and I get to meet new people. Every single Sunday, I get to meet someone new in this church. I come to the 9 o'clock and the 11 o'clock service, and I'm so glad I get to do that. And I wanted to encourage you and let you know that, in case it's not something you had noticed, we have new people, visitors, guests, people who are coming back after a long time every single Sunday. God gives us the opportunity to meet new people. So I encourage you to walk around, say hello, introduce yourself, introduce your family, get to know others. Our scripture lesson for today is going to be very familiar to you for several reasons. Number one, Diane just told you. But also because you have probably heard it many times throughout your life, in church, in Sunday school, and maybe even in secular circles as well. You probably already know that Jesus was an avid storyteller. He taught his disciples by telling them stories that we call parables. Today, I am going to talk about the parable of the lost son, or you may know it as the parable of the prodigal son parable. So what do you think the word prodigal means? What comes to your mind when you hear the word prodigal? Shout it out where you are. What do you think it means?
Misbehavior.
Misbehavior? Absent? Is that what you said? Anybody else? So these are some of the things that come to our minds. Actually, did you know that the word prodigal is nowhere in Scripture? This is a human word that we have added over time when we refer to this parable. It means wasteful. It means that something of value has been given and then wasted. And we're going to read this account of Jesus telling this parable from the Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 15, verses 11 through 32. If you have your Bibles, I invite you to read along or read along on the screen. To illustrate the point further, Jesus told them this story. A man had two sons. The younger son told his father, "I want my share of your estate now before you die." So his father agreed to divide his wealth between his sons. A few days later, this younger son packed all his belongings and moved to a distant land, and there he wasted all his money on wild living. About the time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land, and he began to starve. He persuaded a local farmer to hire him, and the man sent him into his fields to feed the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding the pigs looked good to him, but no one gave him anything. When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, "At home, even the hired servants have food enough to spare, and here I am dying of hunger. I will go home to my father and say, 'Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I am no longer worthy of being called your son. Please take me on as a hired servant.'" Now, so far in this story, we see that one of the two sons asked for something that was not good for him. He wanted to fight for his right to party. And the father, seeing the big picture, gave it to him. Now, I am sure that it grieved this father to let the child strike out on his own like this. It showed tremendous restraint. As a parent, I can only imagine what this may have been like. If my kid asked for that much money from me, I would be afraid to let him have it, afraid to give him that much rope. He might hang himself with it. It's my job to protect him from that, right? But I am looking at this through my human, single focus, small picture lens. And that's the first point that I want you to remember. In your bulletin, on the back of your bulletin, there's an outline. And I invite you, as we're going through this lesson today, from this teaching today, I invite you to fill in this outline as we go along. And this is the first point that I want you to remember. The Father sees the big picture. Our Father in heaven knows what we don't know. He can be trusted because he knows more than we do. He can be trusted to take the wheel because he knows every bump and every curve and every pothole in the road ahead. So in this parable, the Father gives the thing that is asked for, even though he knows that the Son is going to squander it. The heart of the Father sees more than we do. The heart of the Father sees more than we do. And so he returned home to his father. And while he was still a long way off, his father saw him coming. Filled with love and compassion, he ran to his son, embraced him, and kissed him. His son said to him, "Father, I have sinned against both heaven and you, and I am no longer worthy of being called your son." But his father said to the servants, "Quick, bring the finest robe in the house and put it on him. Get a ring for his finger and sandals for his feet, and kill the calf that we have been fattening. We must celebrate with a feast, for this son of mine was dead and has now returned to life. He was lost, but now is found." And so the party began. Before he can even finish his well-rehearsed line, the father interrupts his son. Now remember, the son had practiced what he was going to say. I can imagine him just going over it and over it. The whole walk home, he's just repeating the speech over and over again. So he had practiced what he was going to say. He was going to admit his sin and then ask to be let back into the house as a hired servant. It's not a full restoration as a son, but it's better than eating pig slop, right? But no, not this dad. Oh, no, no. This father doesn't even let him get the words out of his mouth. He does not punish him. He does not shame him. He does not give this wasteful son what he deserves. He deserves punishment. That dad worked really hard for his money. And the son just spent it all willy-nilly. He doesn't even deserve to be a hired servant. He deserves excommunication. He made his bed. He needs to sleep in it, right? No. Instead, we get a beautiful picture of grace. Leave it to Jesus to teach us about grace, right? Remember, this is a teaching parable of Jesus, and he's teaching us about grace. So that's point number two. The Father gives what we don't deserve. That's what grace is. It's getting what we don't deserve. Three times in these verses, the Father says, "Celebrate," when he should be saying, "Punishment." Verse 23 says, "We must celebrate with a feast." And verse 24 says, "So the party began." And there is one more time that he says celebrate, and I'm going to get to that in a few minutes. Not only does the father let this kid off the off the hook, that's mercy. Letting the kid off the hook, that's mercy. He throws him a big party, and that is grace. The heart of the father overflows with grace. Meanwhile, the older son was in the fields working. When he returned home, he heard music and dancing in the house. And he asked one of the servants what was going on. "Your brother is back," he was told. "And your father has killed the fattened calf. We are celebrating because of his safe return." The older brother was angry and he would not go in. His father came out and begged him, but he replied, "All these years I have slaved for you and I have never once refused to do anything that you asked me to do. Told me to do. And in all that time, you never even gave me one young goat for a feast with my friends. Yet, when this son of yours comes back after squandering your money on prostitutes, you celebrate by killing the fattened calf." His father said to him, "Look, dear son, "You have always stayed by me, and everything I have is yours. We had to celebrate this happy day, for your brother was dead and has come back to life. He was lost, but now he is found." And there's that word celebrate again. I love that God is a party animal. I love it. The son that ran away did not deserve a party.
But you gotta fight for your right to party.
That's right. Did that son that stayed back, did he deserve a party? I love this guy. He had worked all his life doing exactly what his dad wanted him to do. He followed all the rules, he obeyed his dad, and he's got a right to party, and he's gonna fight for it. But this brother he has, he does not have the right, does he? The truth is, my friends, neither of them have a right to party. Yet, the father throws a party anyway. Everyone thinks that this story is about the prodigal son that's come home and the father that runs out to meet him. And that's true. It is. But remember what I told you that prodigal means? It means wasteful. Which son was the prodigal? The father blessed them both with all he had to offer. The younger son wasted his blessing through wild living. And the older son, he wasted his blessing, the blessing of the father's heart, because he was too busy hating his wasteful brother. And yet the father still poured out his blessings on both of them. He gave them his heart anyway. To the sinful, disobedient son, he gave him his best robe. He put a ring on his finger and shoes on his feet, even though he deserved the rags of a hired servant. And to the older son, he offered him everything. He said, "Everything I have is yours." And he begged him to come and join the party. And that is point number 3 in your outline. The father rejoices for all his children. 3 times in this parable, the father says, "We must celebrate." Even though he had spent who knows how long pacing the floor, worrying about his younger son. But even in this time, at the same time that he was worrying, he was getting ready to celebrate. He was already preparing the celebration. It said, "Kill the calf that we have been fattening." The father was already getting ready to party. And so when he comes back, he tells the hired workers, "Put him to work." No. He doesn't say that. He says, "Clean him up. Give him a new set of party clothes. Put some ring bling on his fingers and give him some fancy shoes." The servants of God are called to rejoice with the father when the lost come home. We are called to be at the party, welcoming those who want to repent. The ones who are walking back, turning back to God. And we're not just called to be at the party. We're called to hang the decorations, roll out the red carpet, blow up the balloons. We are called to make it happen. The heart of the Father celebrates his kids' repentance. So who is this story even about? Who are the two sons? Who are the father's kids? And to answer that, we're going to go back to the beginning of this chapter in Luke. Tax collectors and other notorious sinners often came to listen to Jesus teach. This made the Pharisees and the teachers of religious law complain that he was associating with sinful people, such sinful people, even eating with them. This is who Jesus was addressing when he was telling the prodigal son story. He's talking about 2 groups of people, sinners and religious people, 2 sons, 2 peoples. In all of Jesus's parables, I believe that he wanted those listening to examine themselves and see where they fell in the story. And we need to do the same. Parables are supposed to teach us a lesson. So what is the lesson that this parable is teaching us? What are we supposed to hear? Am I the wayward son fighting for my right to party? Give me the money. I want to go party. Or am I the self-righteous son thinking I'm the only one who has the right to party? Jesus had some strong words for those who make it difficult for others to access the kingdom, to come to the Father. Matthew 23:13, Jesus says, "What sorrow awaits you teachers of religious law and you Pharisees, hypocrites! For you shut the door of the kingdom of heaven in people's faces. You won't go in yourselves, and you don't let others go in either." Imagine for me for a minute. How would this story be different if the older brother got there first? The text said that the older brother was out working in the fields, and he came home after the son had returned. But what if the younger son, the younger brother, had encountered the older brother first? What if he'd have met his brother instead of his dad? Hey, bro. Long time no see. I know I messed up, but I'm here to beg for dad's forgiveness, and maybe he'll let me work. Maybe he'll let me work the fields, be one of the servants. And the brother, who followed all the rules and did all the things that dad told him to do, he responds with, "Great, come on in. Let's throw a party." No, I don't think so. And that is certainly not what the religious leaders did in Jesus' day. The religious people. They complained that Jesus was associating with sinners and even eating with them. They were so busy being disgusted with the sinners that they missed out on the blessing of the Father's heart. If the older brother had got there first, I wonder if the younger brother would have just said, "Forget it. If my brother is this mad, imagine how much madder my father is going to be. I better turn around now. I better not go there." And then the lost son never comes home. The holier-than-thou older brother has kept the sinner away from the heart of the Father. And then neither of them gets to enjoy the party. Nobody gets to have a celebration. Now, we don't know the older son's final response here, because after all, this is just a story. But his response is not the point of the story. The point is that Jesus used this illustration to teach us about the heart of the Father. So what do we know? We know the heart of the Father sees more than we do. We know the heart of the Father is overflowing with grace. And we know the heart of the Father celebrates the sinner coming home. Church, we are called to have the heart of the Father. We are called to give freely, even when we think the person might squander it. Squander that gift. We are called to offer grace and forgiveness when it is not deserved. We are not called to shame or judge the one who is coming home. The Father has a party planned for the sinner, and that is all of us. The younger brother, the older brother, every one of us, we are all in that boat. And the Father sent us a party invitation anyway. Jesus is the invitation. Because of Jesus, we do have the right to party.
You gotta fight for your right to party.
No, none of us have to fight for our right to this party. It is a gift for those who believe in Jesus and accept them with their hearts and into their lives. John 1:12 says, "But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God." Amen. We all have the right to become children of God when we accept Jesus into our heart and when our heart lives for him with the overflow of grace, with the celebration of his love. Bow your heads with me, please. Jesus. Church, the heart of the Father says, come home. We need to check ourselves. There is someone here today that needs to come home. You have been away from the Father for a long time, and your heart is longing for the Father's welcoming, forgiving kiss. You know who you are. The Holy Spirit is speaking to you right now, I believe, and it's time to come home. The Father is waiting and watching and preparing a celebration. He wants to put the finest robe on you. He wants you to be a part of the most epic party of all time. That might be you. Someone else is here today, and they have been blocking the sinner's way home with judgments and holier-than-thou thinking. When we meet someone who is not living the same way that we are called to show them the heart of the Father, not the self-righteous brother's heart. We need to be hugging them and kissing them no matter what they smell like, no matter what they look like, no matter how they're dressed or what they did on Saturday night or who they did it with. We need to be reigniting the love and compassion in our own hearts, allowing God to use us as welcome signs instead of closed doors. If this is you, the Holy Spirit is calling you. And the Father wants to tell you that he loves you and everything he has is yours. No one who comes to the Father, neither the younger brother or the older brother, has to fight for their right to party, the party that God has planned for them. If that's you, I invite you to pray a prayer in your heart right now. As the choir is going to lead us in our final hymn, I invite you to come to the altar to pray if you would like to respond in that way. If you are either one of these brothers, either one of these peoples. If you want to come to the Father today, I invite you to come while we sing our closing hymn. If you're not comfortable with that, I invite you to come and see me throughout this week. Call me. Call Pastor Michael. Heavenly Father, guide us, lead us as we close this time together. Speak deep into our hearts and draw us to you, draw us to your heart. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.